1982, has a lengthy resume, and just I don't want to leave anything out. I think that given the hour, I think I've covered a broad swath, and we're delighted to have you here. Please join us at the lectern.
Good evening, and thank you all for being here, and thank you.
Can you
sure. Would you mind?
Glasses. We need glasses to see glasses.
That's right.
So thank you for inviting me to address this prestigious conference. Thank you, Ran, David, Ellen. We meet at a time of great upheaval in the Middle East. The last month have seen Israel faced with numerous security challenges, and our government is determined to meet them. The most acute short-term security issue we face is in the north, where the situation on the borders with Syria and Lebanon has become untenable. When the Second Lebanon War concluded in 2006, Hezbollah was deterred, and despite Nasrallah's bluster, had been delivered a severe blow. Unfortunately, we were unable, and the international community unwilling, to consolidate those gains and prevent the rearming of Hezbollah by Iran. Over the last 12 years, Iran has provided Hezbollah with ever more sophisticated missiles. They have transformed a terrorist organization into the most influential actor in Lebanon and one of the most powerful armies in the region. We have taken repeated actions to prevent transfers of game-changing weapons from Iran to Hezbollah through Syria. And exactly 1 week ago, we launched Operation Northern Shield. The initial stage of the operation is to destroy subterranean terror tunnels reaching into Israeli territory, similar to the Hamas tunnels we have uncovered from Gaza. It seems that Hamas and Hezbollah are reading off the very same Iranian terror song sheet. Hezbollah should be under no illusions or misconceptions. They would be wise not to test our resolve. Hezbollah has placed its storehouses in the heart of Beirut and its rocket launchers in presidential neighborhoods, hospitals, and mosques across the southern Lebanon. By positioning its weaponry among Lebanese civilians and using them as human shields, while simultaneously targeting Israeli civilians, Hezbollah commits a double war crime. In the face of such war crimes, we will not hesitate to use our full power in self-defense. We do not seek a conflict and will do all we can to avoid it. Unlike Hezbollah, we have no interest in the inevitable civilian casualties such a war would cause. And if the international community would also like to prevent a war between Israel and Lebanon, they must act immediately to fully enforce UN Security Council Resolution 1701. The resolution called for the disarmament of all armed groups in Lebanon. It further stated that the only armed forces that could operate south of the Litani River are the Lebanese Army and UNIFIL. The meaning of this resolution is clear to all of you here. Hezbollah must be fully disarmed, and its fighters cannot be present in southern Lebanon. Enforcement of these provisions has been non-existent, and therefore we had sometimes the need to take our actions. Not far to the east, the Iranians are actively seeking a full military entrenchment in Syria. This is part of their broader effort to surround Israel on all sides with proxy terror forces. Israel is determined to prevent such a scenario by all means, at our disposal and at any cost. You have heard in the media that Israel had to attack such bases or convoys or infrastructure more than 220 times in the last year, and hopefully we won't have to do it anymore, but we are ready to do whatever is necessary also in Syria. These are just two pieces of a broader regional problem presented by Iran. However, Iran's proxies and efforts to destabilize the region are not the gravest threat posed by the Islamic Republic. The greatest danger has been and remains the possibility of a fanatic regime possessing weapons of mass destruction. For more than two decades, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has consistently and forcefully warned the world of the dangers posed by the nuclear Iran. Regrettably, his warnings went unheeded as the world entered into the deeply flawed and dangerous Iran deal, the JCPOA. Just weeks before the JCPOA was finalized, I met in New York with former Secretary of State Henry Kissinger, and Dr. Kissinger was quite clear in his assessment of the emerging deal. He said it was a moral defeat to the United States and the Western world. The greatest positive shift to come after the Trump administration took office was their new approach to the Iranian issue. They recognized something that has long been clear in Israel. Appeasing violent fanatics has never worked, and it will never work. So Europe and the rest of the international community should join forces with the United States to apply maximum pressure on the Iranians. Everything the world says it wants in the Middle East is at odds with Iranian ambitions and actions. The world wants the conflict in Yemen to end. Iran finances and arms the Houthis. The world wants the carnage in Syria to end. Iran fights for the survival of the Assad regime. The world wants peace between Israel and the Palestinians. Iran encourages Hamas and Islamic Jihad to promote violence and bloodshed. Iran is the driving force between multiple conflicts in the region, and their behavior must not be indulged. The international community must relentlessly confront and pressure them until their behavior changes. For our part, the nations of the region are sick and tired of Iran's efforts to destroy anything we seek to build. Concerns about Iranian aggression play a large part in the budding relations between Israel and the pragmatic Arab nations across the region. They now see what should have been clear for decades. Iran is their most vicious enemy, and Israel stands strong against Iranian aggression. They have come to realize that there is far more to gain from cooperation with Israel than by being our adversary. They see that the same actors who seek our destruction seek to undermine any leadership working for a better life for its people. A more open, peaceful, and prosperous region is a nightmare scenario for the radical forces. Turning to the situation with the Palestinians, we came very close to a broad conflict in Gaza just last month. Over the past few weeks, there have been several terror attacks emanating from Judea and Samaria, not to mention the hundreds of attempted attacks thwarted by Israeli security forces. Decades ago, the Palestinians' leadership invented a narrative of perpetual victimhood. To this day, many of them are unwilling to recognize the legitimacy of Jewish sovereignty within any borders. Hamas in Gaza and the Fatah-dominated Palestinian Authority in Judea and Samaria employ different tactics and use different rhetoric. But however, both have refused to accept the same basic reality. And the reality is that Israel is permanent, and it is a Jewish state, and Jerusalem is their capital. Thank you. The state of Israel is a just and moral national project, and the Jewish people are indigenous to the land of Israel. The state of Israel is shown in word and deed. We understand we are not the only people living in the land of Israel. We have stated on numerous occasions our desire to reach an accommodation that leads to peace and prosperity for Israelis and Palestinians alike. To our great disappointment, Palestinian leadership from Yasser Arafat to Mahmoud Abbas has never demonstrated that they have reciprocal desires. Israel will continue to flourish. Israel will continue to take the steps necessary to safeguard our citizens, strengthen our nation, and build our country. The Palestinians are not blameless victims. When the Palestinian Authority decides to pay terrorists and praise martyrs, shaheeds, it is not due to hopelessness or despair. It is a calculated political decision that alienates every Israeli across the political spectrum from right wing to left wing. In Israel, we yearn for peace and have taken countless actions to advance reconciliation. However, we cannot promote this vision while the Palestinians approach 5 years of refusing to come and sit with us at the negotiating table. And peace certainly cannot be achieved while the Palestinians in Gaza continue to fire rockets, dig tunnels, and launch incendiary kites into southern Israel. If the Palestinians choose to remain on their current self-destructive path, they will continue to watch Israel grow and thrive while history passes them by. If the Palestinians want peace, if they want a better life for the people, they have precisely one option. Sit in the negotiating table with us and reach a mutually beneficial bilateral agreement. This is exactly what happened 40 years ago with Egypt and 25 years ago with Jordan. Even after the death of thousands of Israelis and tens of thousands of Egyptians and Jordanians, we were able to put aside decades of animosity and negotiate directly in good faith to reach historic peace accords. The Middle East is a region in flux, and there are many bad actors looking to take advantage of this situation. Iran, Hezbollah, Hamas, ISIS, and others seek to append the chance of a better future. But this is nothing new. The Iranians have sought to shatter peace, sow bloodshed, and trigger new wars between Israel and our neighbors for the 40 years since Camp David. Despite massive investments made at the expense of the welfare of its own people, Iran has failed miserably in its efforts to undermine the peace between Israel and Jordan. Israel and Jordan. So Israel is eager to engage with these nations and new Arab countries and to work together for the common good of the region. As our partnership strengthens, the mutual benefits of cooperation will only become more and more obvious to all. For this reason, I'm confident that the forces of evil will become further isolated, while the forces of wisdom and progress and peace will eventually prevail. Thank you.
Good, thanks. Thank you.